And now a little story from the Appleseed.
Thank you very much. During summers, I worked at a series of camps, and one of the camps that I worked at was a camp called Camp Horseshoe. It was a YMCA camp, which is just outside of St. George, West Virginia, which is just outside of Parsons, if that clears it up for you. And working in this one cabin was myself, my buddy Skeeter, our friend Wally, and then our buddy Uncle Debo. Now, Uncle Debo was not our uncle. In fact, Uncle Debo was a year younger than we were. But everybody in town called the poor kid Uncle Debo for several reasons. One, because Uncle Debo was the last and quite unexpected of 17 children. And when he was born, his parents were tired, and they couldn't think of a name. So they thought, we'll just call him the boy until something better comes along. And then through the wonders of time and syllabic manipulation, the boy became da boy, which eventually became Debo. And the reason we called him uncle is because as the last of 17 children, he had nieces and nephews who were quite a bit older than he was. So it wasn't uncommon to be walking down Main Street and hear some matronly niece yell out, Uncle Debo, you pull your pants up right now. And I'm going to tell Grandma. So everybody in town just called the poor kid uncle. So the four of us, Skeeter, myself, Wally, and Uncle Debo, we worked in this one cabin. Now, these were big cabins. You walked in the front door, and there was a foyer and benches. You could sit down, take your boots off, hang your jacket up. And then on either side of that foyer, there was a wing. And in each one of those wings, there was probably 25 bunk beds. And if you walked through the foyer, there was another door in the back of the foyer, which led into another little room that was about half the size of the room that we're standing in now. And in that room, that's where myself, Wally, Skeeter, and Uncle Debo stayed. So there was a door in the middle of that wall, and then on either side of that door, there was a bunk bed, and Skeeter slept on the bottom bunk over here. I slept on the top bunk. Wally slept on the bottom bunk on this side, and Uncle Debo slept on the top bunk. And then if you pass straight through that room, there was an exterior door, so the four of us could come in and out of the cabin without bothering the kids. So one day, Wally cut his finger. And he cut it bad enough that we had to take him over the mountain to the doctors, and they gave him some stitches and put him on painkillers. And when we got back to the cabin, we were helping Wally up the stairs into the back door. Okay, we weren't really helping Wally because Wally was on painkillers, and the steps were uneven, and it was fun to watch Wally try and negotiate those stairs. Well, he fell, and had just enough sense to know that this hand was damaged, so he put his damaged hand behind his back, and he reached out to stop himself with the other hand, and when he hit, the two fingers on this hand, these two fingers, they bent all the way. I know, it's neat to see happen to someone else. Because you're like, oh, wow, can the human body do that? And then you're like, oh, no, not successfully. So we had to take him back over the mountain, and they put him in a splint and on even more painkillers. And this time we did help him up the stairs because it was almost supper, and we didn't want to miss that. So we helped Wally up the stairs. We got him in his bed, and then Skeet, Uncle Debo, and I took the kids to dinner, did those activities, got the kids in bed, got in beds ourselves. And I don't know how long we'd been asleep when I heard Skeeter on the bunk underneath of me saying, Bill, Bill, wake up, but don't move. Now, I don't know if you've ever been awoken in that fashion. But that is a difficult fashion in which to be awoken because you know something horrible is about to happen, so your body fills with adrenaline and you want to go, wah! But you know if you go, wah, you're going to die. So I brought myself slowly to consciousness and I said, what's the matter? And Skeeter said, there's a skunk in the cabin. And I looked over the edge of the bed, and sure enough, there was a skunk milling around. And Skeeter said, close the door. And I knew what he meant. We had that door that went into the interior part of the cabin, and Skeeter wanted me to close that. We left that door open at night so that we could hear what noises the children were making that we were going to ignore. And Skeeter wanted me to close that door because he knew that if that skunk went through that door, it was going to go into one of those wings. One of those kids was going to see it. The kid was going to scream and the skunk was going to go off. But I was thinking to myself, out there is 100 14-year-old boys who haven't bathed in a week. I thought, how much worse can it smell? You know, I thought, we ought to take that skunk and hang it like an air freshener. But then I remembered that we were contractually obligated to look after the goodwill of those children. So I leaned forward and I shut the door with a snick, and it didn't seem to bother the skunk. But somewhere in the process, Uncle Debo had awoken. Now, Uncle Debo, he was a farm kid. He was a country boy. Okay, let me try and explain this. There's no better word for it than to say that Uncle Debo was just a little bit stupid, I think is the best way to explain. I think what happened, to be more charitable, I think is the last of 17 children. It's just that all of his older siblings had claimed all of the intelligence genes, and there was just nothing left for Uncle Debo. So he's a farm kid, country kid, but he didn't have a lick of sense. So Uncle Debo said, there's a skunk in the cabin, and Skeeter said, yes. And Uncle Debo said, will it bite? Now, see, that's the wrong question. If a bear comes into your cabin, you don't think, oh, does it stink? If a mountain lion comes in, you don't say, oh, am I going to get a tick, right? It's just the wrong question. I wanted to thump him, but I knew that if I did, the skunk would go off. So Uncle Debo said, there's a skunk in the cabin. Will it bite? And Skeeter said, yes, yes, it will bite. And Uncle Debo said, how did it get in here? And as if to answer that question, the screen door went, eh, and a second skunk came in. So now there were two skunks milling around. And Uncle Debo said, if one of them bites me, will the other? And Skeeter said, yes. He said, they're like hornets. And if you make one mad, you make them all mad. And Uncle Debo said, if one of them goes off, will the other? And I was like, what are they, the Borg? Do they have a collective conscience? And Skeeter said, yes, if one of them goes off, they'll both go off. And by this time, I was laughing. But it was that quiet laugh, that silent laugh like you do when you're in church or at school or, you know, at a funeral. And I could feel Skeeter laughing on that bottom bunk too. But, you know, we were probably rocking that bed on maybe like a 1.5 on the Richter scale. And there are tears coming out of my eyes and going into my ears. And finally, Skeeter got a hold of himself. And he said to me as seriously as he could, he said, Bill, did you brush your teeth? And I thought I knew where he was going with this. So I said, no. And Uncle Debo said, I brushed my teeth. Why is that important? And Skeeter said, because skunks are scavengers. They're like bears. And if they smell a scent that they're attracted to, they'll come and investigate. And skunks love toothpaste. And Uncle Debo said, well, I'll be okay because I'm on the top bunk. And Skeeter said, why do you think people call skunks polecats? And Uncle Debo inhaled. Like he never intended to exhale again. Not like he was trying to kill himself, just like he wasn't breathing for the next 70 years. He just sort of went, ah! Like that. And by now, you know, Skeeter and I, we were almost laughing out loud. I mean, there was no, yeah, we were taunting. I'm not going to deny it. But there was no way we were getting out of this situation alive. Let our tombstone read. They went down taunting. And while that was going on, the screen door went, eh, and a third skunk came in. So now there were three skunks milling around. And Wally'd been asleep through all of this in his drug-addled state. But Wally was one of those, he was a perfect camp counselor. Because he was one of those weird people, one of those sick people who think it's neat to get up early in the morning and watch the sun rise. I have to tell you, I was 24 before I knew the sun did rise. Because all I'd ever seen it do was set. But not only did he like to get up early, but he woke up happy. And he'd wake up, he'd be like, good morning, as he jumped out of bed. And he'd start to sing a song about little birdies and happy trees going chirpity chirp, chirp, chirp. So in the midst of all of this, Wally awoke. And in his drug-addled state, he thought it was morning. And he said, good morning, and he jumped out of bed. and he landed in the center of a triangle of skunks. And he looked down, and with all the innocence of a drunk, he said, "Kitty cats." And he knelt down, and he reached out, and he started to scratch one of the skunks behind the ears. Well, the skunk didn't know what was happening, but it wasn't entirely unpleasant, so the skunk came closer, and Wally picked him up. And he stood up, and he turned to Uncle Debo, and he said, "Look, Uncle Debo, a kitty cat." And the skunk crawled off of Wally's hands and onto Uncle Debo's chest. And Uncle Debo sat up, and he screamed, and the skunk bit him. And then all three skunks just went off. And Skeeter and I were laying there, choking, gagging, laughing. And we heard a voice from off in the ether that said, "Boys, boys, boys, when a man does things purely for his own enjoyment, not for the benefit of God or the glory of others, he will be stained and tainted that others may know." Thank you very much, Appleseed.
Thanks for joining us for a little story from the Appleseed.